opportunities are often the beginning of great achievement. Greeting all, on behalf of Clue for Reverence Foundation, I, Nesla Karik, welcome you all to C4E Knowledge Presentation Series. The article I'm going to feature today is from Issue 4, Digital and Cyber Forensics. Digital forensics is a branch of forensic science which is concerned with the recovery and investigation of materials found in digital devices, whereas cybersecurity is the practice of defending our servers, computers, mobile devices, and all sort of data against malicious attack. To validate electronic evidence, we do require a 65B Indian Evidence Act report. So what is the 65B Indian Evidence Act report, and on what grounds are these prepared? To know more with regard to this topic, I do have with me the very author, Mr. Roshan Jacob, who authored the article 65B of Indian Evidence Act in Digital Forensics with me. Welcome, Roshan. Welcome to Clue for Evidence Foundation.
Thank you, Nesla. Thank you for your warm welcome. So here we go. I have made presentation. Okay. So today we will see what do you mean by 65B of Indian Evidence Act. So first of all, before moving to that, we need to know what do you mean by an evidence. An evidence will be any piece of data which helps or aid in the criminal investigation and also in the court proceedings. So specifically talking about the digital evidences, we need to know what do you mean by digital evidences and how they are admissible in the court of law. So in 65B of Indian Evidence Act, it is clearly written that how an digital evidence or its output is admissible in the court of law. So moving to the section, we have to know what I mean by digital evidences. So digital evidence is any information that is stored, transmitted in binary form that may be relied on it found on a computer hard drive or a mobile phone or among other places. It will be in a pen drive, it will be in CCTV footages or any kind of electronic devices. So digital evidence is commonly associated with electronic crime or an e-crime, such as child pornography, credit card frauds. Now, as technologies increase, there are so many kind of crimes that happens in our surroundings and we don't know even its name too. So every kind of evidence has its relation or it's related to a digital field on electronic evidence. However, digital evidence is now used to prosecute all types of crime, not just an electronic crime. For suspects, emails or mobile phones, files might contain critical evidences regarding their intent, their whereabouts at the time of the crime, and the relationship with other suspects. So typically taking an example of a mobile phone, we know that our personal data or our personal messages, email chats or any social group chat, all are stored in our mobile phone. So by seizing a mobile phone, we could get or access the data of any user or if any crime has committed to that person, we can easily find the data related to the crime. Or we can find out who all are the suspects from the messages or from the phone calls or tower location. So in 65B of Indian Evidence Act, it typically says that how these digital evidences, these are admissible in the court of law. So 65B, admissibility of electronic records. It states that any information contained in an electronic record, which is printed on a paper, stored, recorded, or copied in optical or magnetic media produced by a computer, shall be also deemed to be a document if the conditions mentioned in this section are satisfied in relation to the information and computer in question and shall be admissible in any proceedings without any further proof or prediction of the original. So looking through this definition, we can just cut it into pieces for our easily understanding. So first it is said that the information which is contained in an electronic records, which may be printed on a paper, like if there is any data or a call record, we will just produce in the court as a paper, in a piece of paper. Or if it's a CCTV footage of any kind of crime or any suspected person, we will just copy it in a pen drive or a magnetic disc or a magnetic medium. And what is said that it's deemed to be a document. So when producing these kind of evidences or an electronic output to any court, it is said that it will be considered as a valid proof. So we don't need any kind of proof or any kind of aid to just prove that this is a valid thing. So this itself is a valid thing in the court of law. So there are certain clauses. In first clause, it is typically said, what do you mean by 65B of Indian Evidence Act? In clause two, it deals with the conditions. So we can't take a piece of or a digital evidence as it is. So there are certain criteria or conditions written in this Indian Evidence Act. So first is like, information was produced during the regular course of activities by the person having a lawful control over the computer's use. So taking an example of a computer or a laptop. So the person or any person, he has to use his computer regularly so that only we can get the data. We can't take the data in case that, for example, like on that particular day of the commission of the crime, this person, he has used his mobile phone or used this desktop. So at that circumstances, we can't take that data. So it is said that, clearly said that, this computer or any kind of electronic devices, it has to be in a regular use. Second thing, information has to be regularly fed into the computer in the ordinary course of the said activity. So all the day he has done certain activities in his day. So this kind of activity, it has to be fed into the computer. So, and only that we can take the data from this devices. So throughout the material part of the said period, the computer was operating properly. So this is another important thing. If there is any damage to the electronic device, it will not be admissible in the court of law. So it should be operated in a properly and a regularly manner. And information contained in electronic record reproduced or is derived from such information fed in the computer in ordinary course of activity, as I already said. So there should be a regular use within the digital device. Then and then only we can get or access the data and produce in the court. The primary purpose is to sanctify proof by the secondary evidence. This facility of a proof by secondary evidence would apply to any computer output. Such output being deemed as a document, a computer output is deemed document for the purpose of the proof. So first we need to know what you mean by a primary evidence and a secondary evidence. So primary evidence is like, by seizing a computer device, we could get all the data. So it is a typical primary evidence. So what do you mean by secondary evidence? The output that we get or the printed material, we can't take a computer or a laptop as it is to a court. So it is like a high risk thing. Transportation is a high risk thing. So what we are basically done is that we will take an output or a data that we have assessed or seized and then produce in the court. So it is considered as a secondary evidence, and this is a valid proof in the court of law. But the information was produced or fed into the computer or interlinked computer or one computer after the other in succession, or the computer so used shall be treated as one single computer. So this is said in this clause 3 of Indian Evidence Act or in section 65B. So if there is more than one computer, then, or if there is more than one computer, or the usage of computer is in one after the other, that you mean by succession. So in certain kind of thing, all this computer, we are considering it is a one, and this output we are producing in the court are also considered as a one. So in section or clause 3 of 65B, it is said that by the combination of a computer operating over that period, or by different computer operating in succession over that period, or by different combination of computer operating succession over that period, or in any other manner involving successive operation over that period, in whatever order of one or more computer and one or more combination of computer. So typically take an example of a company or an IT firm in which there are so many computers are there. So what is it, it's done is like there will be a group of computer or a combination of computer will be there. So or one process or one program is done on one computer and after that on another computer. So if any kind of crime occur at that certain firm, we will consider these as a whole. And then we are producing this output or this evidence in the court. And section in clause 4 of Indian Evidence Act of section 65B, it is said that there must be a certificate which identify the electronic record contained in the statement. The certificate must describe the manner in which the electronic record was produced. The certificate must furnish the particulars of device involved in the production of that record. The certificate must deal with the applicable conditions mentioned under section 65B2 of Indian Evidence Act, and the certificate must be signed by the person occupying a responsible official position in relation to the operation of the relevant devices. So there should be a certification for that whole process. And there's a format for this section 2 that how we have to produce this evidences. So in certification process, it is clearly saying that. So when we are seizing a data or when we are copying a CCTV footage in a pen drive, we have to add how it is stored in a CCTV footage or a CCTV devices, or and how we are just getting it in a pen drive, how its storage process are done. Then and then only this will be admissible in the court. Otherwise, it won't be admissible. And the certificate is basically produced by the management of the company or the firm. So a certificate is an important criteria in the admissibility of this digital evidences. And most importantly, such a certificate must accompany the electronic record like computer printouts, compact disc, video compact disc, pen drives, etc. pertaining to which a statement is sought to be given in evidence when the same is produced in evidence. For instance, it is stated, what is it saying that like when we are producing it in a piece of paper or any kind of pen drive, magnetic devices, CDs, VCDs, etc. We have to, the certification is all about this, how we are storing it and how we are producing it in the court. And any information to be taken to be a supplement to a computer, if it is done in appropriate form, with or without human intervention by means of any appropriate equipment, or any information is supplied officially in course of its activities with a view of storing or processing it, even if the computer is being used for those activities. So we know that how a computer is seized, how we will collect the data. There are certain processes, right? Identification, authentication, storing, and the chain of custody tells how it is stored from word to word, the position of this digital evidences. So the certificate also typically says that how it's a kind of chain of custody. Like we have to describe or tell how it is stored and how it is copied in a digital or a pen drive. So next is a case study. So it's a case of state of Tamil Nadu where Suhas Kati. It's decided on 5/11/2004. The case tells like it's a like a social media fraud. Like the accused was a family friend of the victim. The accused wants to marry the victim, but the victim refused to marry another person. Then they broke apart on seeing this accused. So this is an opportunity and asked her to marry. The victim refused again. On being refused, the accused posted obscene defamatory message about the said victim on Yahoo Messenger groups, harming her reputation and insulting her modesty. The accused also forwarded emails received in a fake account opened by him in the victim's name. The posting of the messages resulted in annoying calls to the victim. The calls were in belief of the victim soliciting for sex work. The victim was fed up with the harassment, took steps against it, and filed a report against him. The accused was arrested and he reiterated that he did not do such a thing. So the case is like it's happening day by day in our societies, right? So in every like half of the people are, or basically the ladies or the women, they are a victim of these kind of crimes. Like if they refused a marriage proposal or a like any kind of relationship. So they are being bullied by the cyber police, or certain posts are being made, or certain kind of obscene content are being uploaded in their social media sites. So what we can do for this is, as an like a labor investigating officer, we can seize the evidence, or we can just take the chat records of this person, and then we are producing it in the court as in a documentary evidence. So in that evidence, we will get the time, date, the location of the mobile phones, and IP address may be we will get. So everything we will get, and accordingly the court will take the further proceedings and issues. He was accused liable to the charges under section 469 of IPC, section 509 of IPC, section 67 of Information Technology Act 2000. So arguments raised by defense. The defense counsel argued that the offending mails and message were either sent by the ex-husband or any other person. He argued that the victim herself wanted to marry the accused, and after being rejected, the victim tried to put false allegation on the accused. So judgment, despite all such arguments, the proof was presented before the court. The IP address belonging to the husband was the same as the accused. The owner and eyewitness gave statement against the accused. After relying on the witness and other evidence produced before the court, the Addition Metropolitan Magistrate held the accused guilty of offense under section 469. So it's all said, it's on the IPC sections. He has been punished. So when we are like relating this to section 65B of Indian Evidence Act, what are the basic criteria? Like sometimes he has been uploaded in the mobile phone, right? So we will seize the mobile phone. We will collect the data. Like already said, they have taken the IP addresses. So the IP address that he posted was the same of the victims. So from that, it is said that like he has done certain crimes, and there is also eyewitness. So this eyewitness testimony, it's a gives an aid to this investigation process of proving the crime has taken place. So basically, as sum up, I will tell like 65B of Indian Evidence Act typically said that how the digital evidence is admissible in the court of law, and what are the characteristics and certain conditions that we have to follow in order to admissible this kind of evidence in the court of law. So I feel like everyone understood this presentation, and thank you Clue for Evidence for giving me an opportunity to present my article in this topic. Thank you very much.
I personally thank you for such a wonderful presentation. We came to know more about this section, and you, the case study was also helpful. It helped us to know what are the features of it much better. So I hope and I wish you all the best for your future ventures, and looking forward for your cooperation in future as well. And I also thank all our viewers. If you still have any doubt, please leave in comment section. We'll address it as soon as possible. And thank you once again.